Like every probably young boy, and you know, me being Croatian background, the gathering point was the football on the weekend, you know, and soccer as it was called, you know. And my dad took me to the games, Melbourne, Croatia at the time, here at Olympic Park, and I just loved it. It was just from a small age, you know, from a young age, I just loved it. I used to go home and get, if I got a brand new pair of boots, I'd get them and I'd smell the leather and I'd put it next to my table, you know, and I'd just sleep with it all night. And the same thing with the ball. I'd get the ball at home and I'd try to go down the stairs with the ball or just walk around the house. You know, it was just constantly with me all the time. And, it wasn't anybody telling me to do it. I just enjoyed it. You know, I think growing up in those days having Croatian background was a special time because at the time there was no such place as Croatia in the world. You know, it was just one. It was Yugoslavia, and Croatia was one little state, if you like, of Yugoslavia. And I think the people the immigrants who came to all over the world really wanted that freedom. You know, the country to become a free country. And I think from a young age I was. Because it was a communist country and, you know, people weren't allowed to go freely and stuff like that. I think it was a little bit different from people of other backgrounds like the Greeks and Italians and all that, because they had an identity, you know, whereas we were sort of constantly, you know, people would ask you where you're from or what's your background, and say Croatia, and I say, where is that shown on the map?
When I started out here, I would never have thought that I'd end up having my name up in the grandstand. I mean, I remember when they first built that little grandstand was this little bit here in the middle there, you know, and there was nothing else. And, I can't believe now my name's on the top of it.
Yeah, now, tell me about your debut game. You came on, I remember this because I was over the commentary. You were 17 years old, nobody ever heard of you. Then you came on, like, in the second half, and Branko Colino was the coach, brought you on, and you were playing West Adelaide. And you were excited, everybody, yeah, and the promise was there even from that first game. What do you remember?
Yeah, there's a bit of a story behind that, because I was actually at the RS at the time. And Branko rang me up, and he heard I was doing well for the AOS, and he wanted me to play and sign a contract and play for, it was at Melbourne CSC at the time, the name had changed, and I said, yeah, I said, not a problem, as long as, if you're going to bring me there, I don't want to sit on the bench, I want to play all the games, you know, if you're going to take me out of here, you know, and he said, yeah, not a problem, so I came to the first game, and he put me on the bench. It was that first game, and put me on after 5 minutes at the end of the game, and I don't know, I had a shot, I think, and it went past the post. It was against the Sharks, and I said to him after the game, I said, don't call me again, and I went back to Cam,
number eight.
What, you expected to start?
Well, I said to him, don't call me if I'm not going to play. And you know, in those days, no, you don't think about the money. You just think about it because you do it because you love it, you know. And that's the same as with Melbourne Knights. I mean, when I was a boy, Melbourne Croatia was why I went to watch them every week. And the thing is, we never won a title. We never won we had so many good players and such a good team and club, but we never won an actual title. You know, we got to the minor premiership and all that, and I was just to be part of the first team that won that the first NSL title was for me. I mean, it was the be-all and end-all. You know, I had an offer from Borussia Dortmund, which I had like they sent me a contract and all that sort of stuff, and also this Japanese team. You know, there was rumours of other clubs and all that, but they were the only ones who actually sent over contracts. You know, for me to sign. At that time, the president of Croatia came to Australia for like some sort of visit to see or whatever here, and I remember I was just in my house, I don't know, mucking around at my parents' house or something like that, and the phone rang, and it was a friend of the family's who said, you know, the president of Croatia wants to meet you and your parents. I was like, why would he want to meet me, you know? And anyway, so we go there, we meet up in a restaurant here in Melbourne, and he said to me, like, he wants to turn Dinamo Zagreb into a European club that plays in the Champions League to promote the name of Croatia in the world, you know? And he wanted me to play for him. And he actually wanted me to come back, fly back with them in their, like, private airplane. And I said, it's a bit too much, you know? I was in St. Albans here, the western suburbs, yesterday. Now you want me to fly in your, you know? And I said, well, let me think about it, and I'll go home. And I think a couple of weeks later, I said, you know.
Suddenly, for some reason, it all turned sour. Which eventually led to your move to Celtic. Why did it turn sour?
In a nutshell, the president of the country, obviously, because he brought me over, I was sort of seen as his pet or whatever it is, you know. And his popularity started to go down, and so that meant that you know, if I played well. It was the same. If I didn't play well, it was sort of associated with me, sort of, you know.
Was you serious about
it? Was my boy, and his popularity started going down. There was a lot of what are they called? Allegations of, you know, corruption and all that sort of stuff, and also my form started going down as well, and so it was just there was a big sort of campaign, against me. It got to the point where I would come to a game and I'd scored a goal against Hajduk, which is the biggest derby, you know, and my fans were you know, booing and singing stuff against me.
Even though
you scored in a derby game, and then I thought, you know, this is not football, this is not, you know, and to be honest, I didn't have any really connection to the president apart from that he brought me there. And I got to Glasgow, and already people are, you know, writing things about me, saying things, you know, that I'm crazy, that I'm going to, you know what I mean? If your first impression is, it's very, you know, you've come to a new country, you've never been before, and everybody around you thinks that you're, you know what I mean? It's very difficult. So I said to myself, all right, I'm going to go there, come back, knuckle down, and I'm going to show everybody who I am, you know?
And you did quite successfully.
Exactly. And that was so satisfying. I mean, that was probably one of the most satisfying moments of my life, probably, you know, and fulfilling, you know, because I went to, would you believe it, I'm not really a massive drinker or anything like that, but I went to, I went to, I got voted for Player of the Year, Players Player of the Year in Scotland, and I went to, I went back home and I sat on my couch, which was rented at the time, and I got a bottle of, I don't know what sort of single malt whiskey or whatever, and I just drank it.